Greetings from Blowing Rock First Baptist Church. My name is Pat Ball, and I'm really excited that you've joined me to wind up a little bit of a study of the book of First Peter. I really enjoyed getting these lessons together and spending time with you with my hot chocolate and you with your coffee or whatever you've chosen. I hope you've been encouraged, and I hope that you've enjoyed our first three lessons today. We're going to finish up. We're going to try combining chapters 4 and 5 and see what the Holy Spirit guides us and leads us to in studying these chapters. In chapter 4, one of the main things that Peter does is he wants to encourage his people, these folks from the Roman provinces, to think like Jesus. Not an easy task, not something easy to do, to think like him, to react like him before you fly off, to really do think, what would Jesus do? What would he say? How would he react? He encourages them to remember the past is behind us. Now, I don't know about you, but sometimes that's hard for me. It's hard for me to remember that the things in my past God has forgiven me for are gone. And so Peter encourages them, just live according to the path God has for you. He's laid it out for you. He'll guide you through it, just like we started. In chapter 2, we talked about the footsteps of Jesus. That's what Peter's asking these folks to do. Follow those steps wherever they lead. He asks them to be alert. How do you be alert? How do you keep watching? Well, number one, you stay in this book. You stay in the Word. I've been encouraging you that to do that. All these lessons, read your Bible. Read Proverbs. Read Psalm. Read John. But read your Bible. Stay in the Word and stay in prayer. You cannot follow Jesus without prayer. You can't. It's not possible. He wants them to love each other and not, just like we've talked earlier, not a superficial, yeah, I love you thing, but a true, sincere love from the heart. He wants us to be quick to offer hospitality. He wants us to be generous. He wants to open our homes. He wants to open our pocketbooks. He wants to open our refrigerators. He wants us to be hospitable. Offer a room. Offer whatever your brothers and sisters might need. And in a difficult time, please don't ever forget that you can trust your Heavenly Father. I was blessed to have a godly, wonderful daddy here on earth. John Smith was his name, if you believe that or not. And I thought he could do everything but walk on water. I thought he was Peter. He was just going to get out of the boat. Because my dad was a servant, and he taught me to be a servant. I was blessed to be raised in a house where I was taught that loving God meant serving him in whatever capacity he gifted and talented me to do. And so the big thing that I'm trying to tell you is that you can trust him. It's a huge word. How do we trust a Heavenly Father that we can't touch with skin on? Well, let me tell you. You remember, my favorite word. You remember his mercy and his faithfulness and his graciousness. You remember every prayer that you have had answered. And you remember most of all that his timing is always perfect. And he is not surprised by COVID-19 nor anything else. He is the God of the universe, and he is in control, and he is sovereign. Now for chapter 5 is kind of like the benediction to our book. It's kind of like ending this up, ending up the book. But it has a couple of few things that I don't want us to miss as we final up this book. It is the end of our lessons, and it is a reminder to be content. Contentment's not always easy, is it? But be content with wherever and whomever you are. All of us are different. I love standing in front of you and teaching you. I was born to be a teacher. I taught and taught and taught, and I hope that God allows me to keep teaching until the day he takes me home. But not everybody's comfortable teaching. He warns us also in chapter 5 to wait on the Lord. And be honest with you, waiting is not my strongest suit. It is sometimes more difficult for me. I sometimes forget that, yes, he's in control and his timing is perfect, and I must wait on him, and he will answer. And it also tells us in chapter 5 to cast our cares on him because he cares about you. That's in verse 7 of chapter 5. Whatever your cares are today, and some of us are carrying a lot, maybe some not as much, but all of us have cares. We all have a little bit of something in the back of our mind going, what if? It's hard not to do the what ifs. But I just want to encourage you today to follow what he says right here. Cast your cares on the Lord because he cares about you. The last thought I have for you is to keep your guard up. Keep your armor polished. Keep your nose in the book and be alert. Why? Because verse 8 says, your adversary, the devil, is prowling around like a roaring lion, just looking for whom he can devour. Please keep yourself sharp and be on the alert. Be on the alert, because he is definitely prowling around. We have to resist him. We have to keep our eyes on Jesus. In chapter 2, we talked about an old hymn, following the footsteps of Jesus. I want to leave you with another one. It's called, Turn Your Eyes Upon Jesus. Look full in his wonderful face, and the things of earth will grow strangely dim in the light of his glory and grace. Keep your eyes on him, and may God bless you.
And higher than the mountains that I face, and stronger than the power of the grave, and constant in the trial and the change, one thing remains, one thing remains. Your love never fails, it never gives up, it never runs out on me. Your love never fails, it never gives up, it never runs out on me. Your love never fails, it never gives up, it never runs out on me. Oh.